Welcome. We want to give a warm welcome to all our guests who are worshiping with us for the first time. Special welcome to our friends from St. Boniface Church who are ministering to us today. Today we celebrate the 13th First Sunday in Ordinary Time. My name is Darcy Nash. Our interpreter today is Suzanne Bernard. Our Mass intention, we pray for the repose of Juanit Piene. We also pray for all our benefactors, guardians of this community, and for their families. We also pray for the healing and recovery of all our parishioners experiencing pain and illness, especially those undergoing treatment for cancer and those recovering from major surgery. We also pray for all our parishioners who are homebound. We pray for the intentions of those listed in our prayer list. We also pray for peace in Ukraine, Israel, Gaza, and the world. We pray for the souls in purgatory. We pray for an increase in attendance at our chapel and renewed spirit of service to those who enter our doors. We also pray for an increase in vocation to the priesthood and religious life. Our theme is Hear, Listen. The reading for today's Mass are in the Heritage Missal, page 251. I repeat, the readings for today's Mass are in the Heritage Missal, page 251. The books for the front pew are underneath the pew. Our celebrant is Father Robert Bouffier.
We stand as we begin our Mass with song, our
together once again in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Today, the readings really focus on living the commandments and what that means. It's not just jumping over hurdles to get to heaven. It's a new meaning, it's an important meaning that Jesus restores in his own life. So we ask him for forgiveness.
Lord Jesus, you raise the dead to new life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us together to everlasting life.
Amen.
Faithful offer you right and praiseworthy service. Grant, we pray, that we may hasten without stumbling to receive the things you have promised through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses spoke to the people, saying, "Fear the Lord your God and keep throughout the days of your lives all his statutes and commandments, which I enjoin on you, and thus have long life. Hear then, Israel, and be careful to observe them, that you may grow and prosper the more in keeping with the promise of the Lord, the God of your fathers, to give you a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. Therefore, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. Take to heart these words, which I enjoin on you today." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Response to story. I love you, Lord, my strength.
I love you, Lord, my strength.
I love you, Lord, my strength.
I love you, O Lord, my strength. O Lord, my rock, my fortress, my deliverer.
I love you, Lord, my strength.
The Lord lives, and blessed be my rock, and extolled be God my Savior, you who gave great victories to your King, and showed kindness to your
Our second reading today is a reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, the Levitical priests were many because they were prevented by death from remaining in office. But Jesus, because he remains forever, has a priesthood that does not pass away. Therefore, he is always able to save those who approach God through him, since he lives forever to make the intercession for them. It was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, higher than the heavens. He has no need, as did the high priest, to offer sacrifice day after day, first for his own sins and then for those of the people. He did that once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints men subject to weakness to be high priests, but the word of the oath, which was taken after the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. One of the scribes came to Jesus and asked him, "Which is the first of all the commandments?" Jesus replied, "The first is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." The scribe said to him, "Well said, teacher, you are right in saying he is one and there is no other than he, and to love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is worth more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices." And when Jesus saw that he answered with understanding, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And no one dared to ask him any more questions. The Gospel of the Lord. If we recognize the God within us, within each one of us, and the God in each one of our brothers and sisters, Then we are called to love the image of God in ourselves and in them. And that is the entirety of the commandments, which may be made more explicit in individual ways. But the principle is very certain. There is only one God. There is only one Lord. And we must orient everything about ourselves, others, society, politics, Halloween candy, to the Lord God, and find ways that we can continue to grow, learning more and more what commandments help us to live that soul love of God in others and in ourselves. That's pretty much the message of today. This is the single prayer that goes all the way back to the time of Deuteronomy, that every loyal Jew, every one of the chosen people, prayed every morning and every evening. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. That is very, very important now for the chosen people who live in Christ Jesus, because that knowledge allowed Jesus to face the worst of sufferings and to rise above those sufferings and to rise even above death. So we can recite it morning and evening as well. Hear, O chosen people, the Lord our God is one. You must love God in all God's creatures, in all of creation, in every single person that is here, in everyone who has ever lived. We just went through that, actually, didn't we? November 1st is the Feast of All Saints. We say All Saints because we know the names of quite a few of them, but we don't know the names of all of them. Who are the saints who live in heaven, who live united with God, who have undergone the test of this world, and who have purified their own love of God and others? There are so many of them. So many of them in our own experience. Sometimes I can recognize them right off the bat. I have told other people, this is a real saint. That's important because I get to see a facet of God in that person. And the word facet is important because it is very similar to a diamond. A diamond has many, many facets. I don't know, anybody got diamond rings here? There we got two, both hands. Oh my heavens. Anyone else? Back there, here, over here. Okay, when you look at a diamond, you see that it flashes several different ways because each cut in it is a different reflector. It shines back differently and it dazzles us. We love that. And so we together are God's diamond. Every single person flashes back a particular facet, a particular piece of God's person. We are images of God. And when we meet saints in our lives, we really can say, I know there is a God because I see God in you. And the chief of all the saints, the queen of all the angels and saints, is the Blessed Mother. And that's so important because she carried God within her. And why she is important, St. Augustine said, is not because she bore Christ in her womb, but because she bore him first in her heart. So we don't just honor Mary in order to honor her. We honor Mary in order to follow her, so that anyone who looks at any one of us should be able to say, I see God within. That's a tremendous challenge, a great difficulty, but it is the truth. God created each of us in God's own image and likeness. From Adam on down to any one of us today, to the baby that will be born today. The image of God is in that person. And that is why Jesus so clearly added that second commandment. The second is like the first. You shall love your neighbor as yourselves. And so we have a real challenge there. I think most of us stumble over the very last word in that commandment, to love yourself. Obviously, when you talk about love, you're not talking about selfish love or love that is rewarded or love that is lustful. We're not talking about that kind of love. When we look at ourselves, we often are worried about what we see. We often feel badly that we have not changed. As I told you, on November 30th of this month, I will celebrate my 50 years of the priesthood, which is a major mark. But I suffer the temptation of everyone else. I look at myself and I say, 50 years hasn't gotten me much closer to the Lord. No. We all have things that we are working on, that we struggle with. If we are a facet of God's image, we also carry within us a little package of bad that erupts every so often and that causes us grief and the people around us grief. But if that's what the people see when they look at you, they see that package of bad, they see that evil influence, then you're not doing what God wants. God wants you to love yourselves as images of God. God wants you to work all the time. And it is all the time. It's year after year, day after day, all the time. To become more loving, more giving, more forgiving, more merciful. It's not to follow commandments as if they are rules, legislation, demands. To follow the commandments of the Lord is to get a huge step up to understand who we are for ourselves, for one another, and for God. God kind of gives us a break. We don't have to figure this out. He tells us already. And God's commandments are not spoken or written. Don't steal. Don't kill. God doesn't say that. He says, you, my chosen people, my facets of myself, you, images of my divine love, won't steal. You, my beloved, won't kill. It's not, you must not, you cannot, it's, you shall not, you will not. So we focus on the image of God within. I know this is greatly difficult because religion, you know, religion means to bind again, to re again, ligare, to bind up again. That's religion. And those of us who have joined religious life, who are professed and consecrated brothers and sisters and ordained brothers in religious communities like the Jesuits or the Dominicans or the Franciscans, or in my case, the Marianists, we pledge ourselves to live the rule of life of the Marianists or the Franciscans or the Dominicans, Benedictines, or et cetera, et cetera. And that rule of life has a lot of things that we're supposed to do. And I, as the superior of my community, I'm no longer that. I ended my task June 15th. Very happily so. Now I can look at everything going on in my community, among the community members, and say, not my problem. So that's a very nice thing, not a nice thing to have. Of course, it remains my issue. Every brother remains my issue. But it's very important that we don't think that we have to do rigidly. We are required to do these things. The spirit is always more important than the letter. The letter of the law enables us to do these things better. I remember being asked once, why do I have to go to confession? Why can't I just ask God to forgive me? I say, you don't have to go to confession. You don't even have to go to heaven. You know, there's no requirement, you know. Nobody's going to push you to that law. These are aids, helps, wonderful ways that God has given to us to become more like ourselves, the images of our great and glorious God. That's the thing that's going on. You can, you know, sometimes in the religious life also, you break some rules. Today also, you know, when a saint's day is on a Sunday, we don't really celebrate that saint. You know that. That's in the church that happens. And today is one of our, well, one of my most cherished saints, because in my grade school, I was taught by the Dominican sisters, sisters of St. Dominic of Amityville. And so they showed me St. Dominic and all. And a special Dominican saint is Martin de Porres, whose day is today, November 3rd. Usually it doesn't fall on a Sunday, but it does today. So what Martin de Porres, there's a great, you know, he was actually a lay brother, never was ordained. He worked at menial tasks, and he was a porter. He answered the door, arranged different things in the house, worked and toiled and labored among the brothers, always known as a person who did show God. Except one day, he actually brought in this individual man covered in sores, you know, what we'd say suppurated sores, sores that were leaking and all over the place. And he tried to help him, and he brought him into the community, into the religious house, and he put him in his own bed. The superior of the community was incensed, was totally angered, saying, you brought this diseased, dirty, filthy person in here, and he's going to soil up everything in the community. The whole community is going to suffer by this. How could you do that, Martin? And Martin, who is probably, according to the rule of life, one of the lowliest members of the community, looked at the highest member of the community, the superior, and he simply said, I can wash the sheets. I cannot wash the guilt of not caring for one of God's chosen. And I feel with both of them in this story, because as the superior is in charge of keeping everyone healthy and well and keeping everyone on the road, you know, of course. But Martin, whose compassion was so great that he physically cared for this ill person, recognized that in this person who just looked filthy and repugnant and horrible, was the beauty of God, was a facet of God, and took care of them. I think we don't have to go back that far to see in a person like Mother Teresa the same kind of thing, who walked the streets of Calcutta and encountered the dirtiest, filthiest, most sick and dying people and cared for them. Now, God doesn't always ask us to do that. But we have to be honest with ourselves and say, okay, there are certain people that we do care for because we love them. There are certain people we care for because they care for people we love. We can do that. But Jesus would probably say, so can the non-believer. Jesus would ask us, if you believe in me, you have to constantly try to widen the sphere and the scope of your love. And I can't tell you how often I have passed someone in the street, at Walmart's, when I go in, who is begging, and I say, walk right by, or put your head down, all of that. Okay, maybe there are reasons for not helping, but then you should keep those reasons in your head and find another way to help. Give to a charity. Give to other people who do care. Those things you can't just ignore. That comes from my experience of Martin de Porres, my own experience, my woeful experience of myself. So I'm not preaching from the mountaintop or from the highest tower. I'm preaching from what God is asking us to do here. The reason Jesus added, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, is because that is the way to love God with all your mind and heart and understanding and strength. That is the way to do it. Jesus shows us that. He suffered for us, not for himself, as the second reading says. He has no need of doing that. He did it for us. And so we, in turn, must do it for one another. And today, I love coming here. I really do love coming here. And I said, I get an injection of faith every time I'm here, because I see caregivers. I see those who share that kind of love in such a clear and visible fashion that it renews my poor attempts at doing the same thing. This is what we must do. We must care for each other. We must love each other. And it has to extend beyond the rewards we get for doing so with our loved ones. It has to go beyond that. So there's a clear message today. So let's now stand and profess our faith. Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? This is the faith of our church. We are proud to profess it in union with all those who have gone before us and who live among us. And now we bring our prayers and petitions to the Lord, confident in his compassion and generosity.
For our Holy Father, Pope Ben, that will thrive spiritually, physically, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For civil servants who labor to maintain clean water, dependable power, and reliable communication systems, that they be blessed in their efforts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who labor to gather in the harvest, that they and their important work be appreciated. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For first responders, that their dedication to public health and safety remain strong. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are living with terminal illness, that they always feel God's love, care, and compassion, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the reposed soul of Juanita Penite. We also pray for all our benefactors, guardians of this community, and for their families. We also pray for the healing and recovery of all our parishioners experiencing pain, illness, especially those undergoing treatment for cancer, and those recovering from major surgery. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for each of our particular intentions that we remember now silently. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for our final one, let us remember the souls in purgatory. We did remember them yesterday, but we ask God and all the saints to lead them to fulfillment and peace. We pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the wonders that we are. We give you thanks for the call that you have given to us to share your magnificent life and love with all the world, especially those you place in our sight, in our care. We ask you, hear us and answer us through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Our offertory this morning is number 483 in the Heritage Missal, earthen vessels number 483.
Sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, become for you a pure oblation and for us a holy outpouring of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
He is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration. They may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, on the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your Pilgrim Church on earth with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and Thomas, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we too hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Midst and at his command, let us pray as he taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
every evil, and grant us peace in our hearts, in our homes, and in our world. In your mercy, keep us free from sin, and protect us from all that would harm us, as we await with blessed hope the coming in glory of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours.
Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of that peace.
Oh, God, you take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
This morning is number 409 in the Heritage Crystal. Please seat 409.
Thank you.
Let us pray. May your power, O Lord, at work in us, increase us, we pray, so that renewed by these heavenly sacraments, we may be prepared by your gift for receiving what they promise through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
I forgot about the announcements, so sit back down for a bit.
Warm greetings to all our friends watching this Mass online. We would like to invite you to join us in person every Sunday at 9:30 here in Cooper City, Florida. Please remember to share this Mass with your friends on Facebook. By doing so, you help us spread the word about our ministry to persons who are deaf or disabled. We hope to see you soon. Join us on our mission to spread hope. Become a missionary for our chapel. By praying for us, remember us in your prayers at 9 p.m. during the great hour of mercy. Inviting others, bring a friend to Mass or to one of our events. Spread the word. Help us distribute our flyer to those interested in learning more about our chapel or share our Mass through social media. Please join us for coffee and pastries after Mass. This is a good opportunity to meet your fellow parishioners and guests. All are welcome. Our Mass recordings are now archived on our YouTube channel. More information will be forthcoming. Faith formation will take place as usual. We want to sing happy birthday to all our members who are celebrating a birthday this week at home or here at church.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
Your St. Jude Chapel at Shaw Communities is in great need of your financial contribution. You can now send your weekly offering through the link posted in our official Facebook page or scan the QR code in our Sunday bulletin, which is posted online. We thank those whose love and generosity made possible that we continue to open our doors to minister to all our disabled brothers and sisters. We wish everyone a blessed, safe rest of the week. And please remember to take a copy of our bulletin.
And I thank you for your kind attention because you were all so alert after that extra hour of sleep. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord and his people. Thanks be to God.
Number 512, Heritage Epistle, Glory and Grace, number 512.